Welcome to the Industry Experts Panel at PortfolioWealthGlobal.com. My name is Michelle Holliday. Today, we are welcoming back to the show Mr. Carl Denninger. Carl is an American technology businessman, a finance blogger, and a political activist. He is one of the founding members of the Tea Party movement. Carl is the host of the Market Ticker podcast at market-ticker.org, and we're looking forward to hearing his perspective on everything that's going crazy throughout the world and across our country. Carl, welcome back to the show. How are you today?
Thank you for having me on.
We are thrilled to have you here. I'm going to do something a little bit different. Usually I choose the questions, but Carl, things are going so crazy. I want you to name a couple of the top, say five concerns taking place right now in American politics, and then I want you to choose number one and talk to us.
Okay, well, the top one would be demographics, because demographics is destiny. The second would be the explosion in the federal budget that nobody is paying any attention to, and yet it's been a topic that I've been making a stink about for more than 20 years, and where it's coming from. The third would be trade-related issues, which tie into the other two. Fourth would be issues in other nations that are related to the rule of law, along with those in the United States. And then the fifth would be the political implications of all of that and how it all folds into what's going on now with the election season cranking up for 2020. In terms of the one that is worth spending the most time on, I'd love to say demographics, but the problem with that is it doesn't matter how big of a problem you think that is, because it takes 20 to 30 years, sometimes 40, for those issues to come up. And then it takes another 20 to 40 to fix them, because that's just how long it takes to make children and grow them into adults. So even if you recognize a severe demographic problem and you put in place incentives to try to fix that, the reality of it is that you're going to suffer with whatever that problem is for the next 20 years, and there isn't anything you can do about it. So right. This is
now, Carl, be specific. What is the demographic problem?
Well, the demographic issue we have today is that the federal government, along with the states, have made it essentially not worth it to become entrepreneurial. They've destroyed the entrepreneurial base, and that base is really very simple at its core. That is, you acquire assets at a reasonable price, reasonably cheap price, you hope. So you want to take advantage of dislocations and other people's misery and problems, and you use that to produce goods and services, and that's how you get wealthy. Instead, what we have is a series of asset bubbles that have made it impossible, for the most part, for people to acquire those assets at a reasonable price. And so what you've built is an edifice of debt, because it's the only way to even get something as simple as a house. The problem with doing this is that if young people see this, then they say, well, why would I bring children into the world when all they're going to be is wage slaves? Or worse, going to end up on the unemployment line, sucking on Medicare benefits and Social Security disability. And so you over time, the more intelligent, more analytical focused people, who are the people you want to do the reproducing, right? Because that's how genetics works. They decide, well, I'm not going to make children. I'm not going to pair off into couples, and I'm not going to have babies. And oops, okay. And then 20 years later, you look at what's going on in the country, and we have a flood of H-1Bs coming in from India, destroying the high-end job market. We have a flood of illegal immigrants coming in from Mexico and El Salvador and other countries, destroying the low end of the job market. And so if you're on the lower end of the job market, what future do you have? It used to be, the old rubric is learn to code. Well, what good does that do you when some Indian H-1B guy comes in here and throws you out of a job, which has happened at multiple U.S. corporations here in America? Disney fired their entire IT department, replaced them all with Indians. So, I mean, this is, this kind of stuff has been going on for a very long time. It was starting back in the 1980s and 1990s. But it has now gotten to the point that if somebody says to me, well, I'm 17, should I go to college? What should I major in? My answer is, well, maybe you ought to go into being an AC tech or a plumber or an electrician, because it's pretty hard to offshore the guy that comes and unclogs your toilet at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Right. Right. It's so sad. The college, you go to college these days and you come out with a minimum of an average of $40,000 worth of debt. It's crippling to the people coming out of college right now. And I don't think much of society realizes the anger this is causing. And that's the reason most people are looking toward socialistic points of view. They don't understand that they are the ones that are going to be paying for the college of these people coming up in 10 years if they go socialistic and many other factors. But talk to us about what this debt is doing to the people that are coming out of college right now.
Well, that is part of this demographic disaster, and it's part of what's driving it. If you come out of school and you've got $100,000 worth of debt, you, unless somebody disregards it, you do not qualify to buy a house. Okay, that's just the way it is, because your debt-to-income ratio is too high, you're not going to qualify. And at that point, what are the real options? Well, you'll have lenders that will ignore that. The problem with that is you're going to end up getting foreclosed on, and you're going to default on your student loans because you can't make the payments. So the bottom line issue here, though, is that what we've done is we've demonstrated to these people, although we won't talk about it, we won't put this in front of young people, we've demonstrated that socialism doesn't work because we removed the price signal from the college education market. Price signals are the most important things in any economy. When you are driving your car and you're almost out of gas, and there's two gas stations, one is 3 cents a gallon cheaper than the other, the difference between you going into one or going into the other is probably a quarter. Right? I mean, it's literally, we're talking about under a dollar in the difference between filling up your car with one versus filling up your car in the other. And yet, all you got to do is take a look at those two gas stations, which one's got the lines at the pumps and which one has no cars. Okay, and yet we are talking about an absolutely insignificant amount of money. But that's how price signals work. They force everybody into confluence with trying to actually optimize their operations and lower their costs so that they can keep prices down. The educational market has destroyed this by putting the government in charge of all student loans and backing them, along with getting rid of bankruptcy protection. You used to be able to file bankruptcy, and student loans were unsecured debt. They got thrown away just like your credit card debt did. So, if you got pushed too hard, that's what you did. This was a natural check and balance on the cost of college, because if I go to get a sociology degree and my best and highest employment when I come out of school is going to be about $40,000 a year, nobody's going to loan me $100,000 to get a $40,000 a year job. They're not going to do it. Okay, so how does the college charge $25,000 a year to go get a sociology? They can't, because nobody's got that kind of money and nobody's going to pay it in exchange for a $40,000 a year job. They're just not going to do it. Well, did we need this in order to advance? I would argue the answer is absolutely not. We put men on the moon with guys who went to college with slide rules. They didn't have computers. They didn't have anything fancy. They had brick dorms, cinder blocks with a couple of beds in them and a place to use the toilet and a shower. And yet, calculus has not changed in a very, very long time. And if anything, things like computer science have gotten ridiculously cheap. When I was in school, the kind of mainframes and mini computers and things like this that you needed to learn computer programming cost $1 million. Now you can go buy a Raspberry Pi for $25. And use your TV as a monitor and buy a $30 keyboard at Walmart and a little SD card. And for under $100, you have a functional computer that you can learn programming on. Why do we have computer science courses that cost, you go to school for 4 years, it costs $100,000. That's stupid. I can learn how to program for zero and $100 worth of equipment in my own house.
You bring up such an incredible point, and I don't hear people talking about this point, but it's so glaringly obvious that the infrastructure of what you need to learn, what you need to know coming out of college has cost-wise dropped so dramatically, because prices to do it, the large frame computers and whatnot, they're irrelevant anymore. Now it's very, very cheap to learn these things. And yet, college has not just doubled, tripled, you know, it's quadrupled at the very least. So is this a form of corruption, Carl? What's happening here?
Well, socialism. Essentially, that's what you have. You have socialism and communism. You have colleges, including very prestigious ones such as Harvard, that openly discriminate against people who are of certain races and penalize their entrance scores and their tests and give bonus points to people because they happen to have the right skin color or the right national origin or whatever have you. And they do this all in the name of diversity. But the fact of the matter is that we're supposed to be a meritocracy. If you happen to have a higher IQ and you're more capable of something, then you're, in theory, you should have better opportunities that open up to you because you're better at whatever it is that you're doing. It's not that, you know, you're white or you're black or you're purple or whatever. It's that you can perform mathematical calculations faster than the other guy. You are more accurate in your prose and in your thought processes. You come up with crazy formulas and people say, oh, no, that's nonsense. And then you go into a lab and you test it and it turns out you're right. Okay. And this is how we make advancements. You know, when America decided to go to the moon, we did not know how to trap breathable oxygen in a suit with zero outside pressure. We literally did not know how to do that. We didn't know how to make a zipper that would hold gas pressure so you could get into the suit, zip it up, and have it hold pressure, which it obviously had to do, or you can't walk on the moon, right? Because there's no oxygen there. So we figured out how to do that. We figured out how to make a computer that was small and light enough that could guide the capsule, because the re-entry angle that we had coming back into the atmosphere was small enough that no human being could shoot that accurately enough. And if you didn't, you would die. There was no maybe about it. You could not possibly fly that capsule on re-entry by hand. It could not be done. And so we had to come up with a computer that could perform those calculations and do that steering by itself. Well, we did that. But we didn't know how to do any of these things when it started. We didn't know how to we knew how to do exactly zero of this. We have destroyed, think about the innovations that we supposedly have had over the last 20 years, right? What have they all been? What have we actually done? What do we got? We have massive databases now that allow you to share cat pictures all over the place. And then politicians who have shared images that show up that embarrass them, and so they have to resign. This is our best and highest calling today. Okay? What did we get out of the 1960s and the early 1970s with these other programs? With amazing innovations. We've done exactly nothing. And now all we are is scolded that we're ruining the earth, and that we have to quit using fossil fuels when energy is the reason we have made all of these advances. And the place that I grew up in at the time, you could not eat the fish out of the river. Your eyes watered when you went by the chemical plant that was a couple of miles from my house. Today, I can see the bottom of that same river and there is no odor at all because we've cleaned it all up. Okay, and yet we're all of a sudden terrible people. And yet we made all this progress. When you think about this in terms of other parts of the world, okay, other nations, there are 1.3 billion humans today that do not have electrical power in their homes. They just don't. Anyone that thinks that the Greta Thunbergs of the world are going to tell these people that they will never have electrical power in their homes because they can't use coal, and they can't produce any carbon emissions in order to have electricity. And oh, by the way, you have to emit carbon in order to make things like solar cells and windmills. Okay, never mind that they don't work all the time. The solar cell doesn't work when the sun's not up, and the windmill doesn't work when the wind's not blowing. All right, so you're going to tell 1.3 billion humans that they have to live in straw huts for the rest of their natural lives, and they have to use the bathroom in the street. I don't think so. We got where we are because we exploited energy resources. What right do we have to tell somebody else that they can't?
You know, this brings up a great point. I want to explore this Green New Deal with you. And I also want to explore the origin of it, because there's a group called the Justice Democrats that are very suspicious. They were, just for the background, very briefly for everyone, they were formed by three people out of the San Francisco area. They are socialists, They wanted to form a new party. And instead of doing that, what they did was they're calling themselves as their new party, the Justice Democrats, and running as Democrats. And what they do is they actually, these three people audition people, actors, to run. This is incredible. Most people have never even heard of this. They audition people to run as candidates for the Democratic Party. They fund them. And then what they do is they, these candidates, the winners, the chosen ones, they basically spout the scripts of these three people, the scripts. Right. They are socialists. And their candidates of 2016 include AOC and the other three within the squad.
The squad
and,
members,
right. And they have a bunch of new candidates coming up in 2020 that they have auditioned. These are actors.
Yeah.
It's highly questionable of who the Justice Democrats are actually funded by, but these are socialists and they're taking over the Democratic Party. They're posing as Democrats. And people are like, the far left Democrats, they're not Democrats. They're socialists that have infiltrated the Democratic Party. Carl, I want you to talk about this. This is incredibly important right now in our history.
Well, yeah, socialism never works. Okay. This is the problem with socialism, no matter where it is that it destroys the price signal. And when you destroy the price signal, you ultimately end up with something that costs 10 or 20 times as much as it should and delivers poor quality. There's an old saying from the Soviet Union, back when it was the Soviet Union, before it was Russia, okay? And it was, you pretend to work, I'll pretend to pay you. And essentially, that's what it devolved into, because the baker knew that he'd get paid whether he baked any bread or not. And so you all had a chit that said you were entitled to a loaf of bread, but when you went to the store, there was no bread because he decided he wasn't going to show up and make any. And why should he? There's no price signal to tell him to do it. All right? You look at what's happened with healthcare in this country. Healthcare is a socialist system in the United States right now. There are fewer than 2% of Americans who pay cash for their healthcare on the barrel. Almost nobody does. And the reason is that you have Medicare and Medicaid at the lower end and for seniors. You have so-called private insurance. You cannot get a price for anything anywhere. And as a result, you have situations like Sovaldi, a cure for hepatitis C, that costs $900 for the entire course of treatment in India. You can fly over to India. It's 90 pills, one pill a day. 90-day course of treatment, hepatitis C is cured. You buy that same treatment here in the United States, it costs anywhere between 40 and 80 grand. Now, how do you have that kind of disparity in price in a capitalist system? You don't. It doesn't last an hour. Because why would I pay $80,000 for something I can get for 900 bucks? That's stupid. Okay? And yet that's what goes on every day. Go into, say, hey, you know, my side's hurting. I think I need my appendix out, right? The doc, you know, squeezes your side. Ow, you know, it hurts there. Okay, you need your appendix out. Okay, how much is having my appendix out going to cost? He won't tell you. He literally won't tell you. You cannot call him and then call another hospital and say, how much did my appendix out? How much did my pay? You can't do this. And if you do, and he says, well, maybe about $10,000. And then you get the bill and it's $18,000. Well, you know, we made this stuff illegal in the car industry. The car repair industry used to do this to people all the time. You'd say, well, you know, my brakes are making a funny noise. The guy put it on the rack, and then after it was up on the rack and you'd already signed the work order, he'd say, oh, by the way, it's $2,000 because you need all new this and this and this and this and the other. And you didn't know whether he was shining you on or whether you really did need that much work, right? That got made illegal. You have to get a binding estimate now before the guy does you, okay? And of course, he's got your car in here and you already did the work before. He says, well, you don't give me the $2,000, you don't get your car back. All right? Well, it's the same thing that goes on today in the medical system all day long, and yet most people think that this doesn't impact them because they get their health insurance from their employer, and they say, well, this is not a big deal. Well, guess what? The average health insurance cost for a single person to an employer today in the United States is about $10,000. For family coverage, it's about $20,000. When I was running my company in the 1990s, we had highly variable pricing, and every company does, but they can't talk about it. It's illegal to tell your individual employees what this is and what this impact is. You literally can't put this on a pay stub. You'll go to jail. All right. But I had people in my office that cost $100 or less a month to insure. And then I had people in my office that were costing $500 and $600 a month doing the same job. But I could not discriminate against them. I couldn't fire the person that was costing me $500 or $600, or I'd have an EEO person in my office suing me within an hour. All right. And yet people think this is all, you know, oh, no big deal. Well, guess what? A good part of the reason most people that have that $500 or $600 bill have that $500 or $600 bill is they're 100 pounds overweight, they're diabetic, and they drink too much, or some combination of those things. Okay. Well, guess what? That's all under your control. But I'm not allowed to use that as a qualifying factor. And, oh, by the way, you're not allowed to go into the doctor's office and say, well, I have diabetes. How much is this medicine to treat it? And they say, well, you know, that's $400 a month. And you say, well, I don't have $400. Say, well, if you stopped eating carbohydrates, your blood sugar would probably normalize and you wouldn't have diabetes. So $400 for the medicine or zero by getting the Rice Krispies out of your diet? Shouldn't we be, where's the price signal? See, there's no price signal anymore. We don't have any incentive to cut out the stupid stuff. And so that's what happens. We are spending 5 times as much in this country today on healthcare as we should be. $1.576 trillion in the last fiscal year that ended September 30th. It's growing. That's just Medicare and Medicaid. It's growing at 8% a year. It has been for 30 years. And by 2024, it's going to bankrupt the federal treasury and all of the states unless it is stopped now. And it doesn't matter who wins.
Wow. I've never heard that statement before.
I've been talking about it for 25 years.
Of all the podcasts I've listened to with you, I've not heard that nutshelled in that way.
I used to give long-form speeches to the Tea Party groups. Some of them are still on YouTube. I went through all of these numbers. This goes back to before the ACA was passed. And I first recognized this problem back in the 1990s when I was running my internet company. I was looking at the trends. I extrapolated it forward, and I came up with 2028. Well, I'm 4 years off, and that was in 1994.
That is so scary.
Well, here's the reality. We currently spend last fiscal $1.576 trillion. Okay? The entire federal government took in last year $3.5 trillion in taxes. By 2024, we will try to spend between Medicare and Medicaid, plus interest on the debt, plus defense, more than we take in taxes. We've paid for nothing else. We haven't even paid the light bill for the Capitol building. We haven't paid Social Security. We haven't paid anything else, but we spent all the tax money and everything else is going to be deficit. And that's if we have no recession. If there's a recession, and there will be eventually, there always is, okay? What happens in a recession is that your employment tax receipts do not go down a whole lot because while people do get fired, most people are still working, okay? What goes down is your capital gains taxes. Those taxes go to zero because there are no capital gains in a recession because asset prices are falling. Okay, so nobody's paying any capital gains tax, but today people are paying a lot of capital gains tax. Well, so that goes to zero. So you would see $3.5 trillion in tax receipts go to probably about three, and you try to spend $3.2 trillion between interest, defense, and Medicare and Medicaid. And somebody is going to stick the middle finger up in the bond market and say, I don't think so.
You know, I have to say, it's almost comical, the situation that we're in. If it wasn't so tragic, it would be almost comical. Because what you spoke with, you know, as far as the numbers that you just referenced, as far as what we're going to be spending in healthcare, and just everything else, the deficit being over $22 trillion. Then they're talking about the Green New Deal, which Elizabeth Warren, Carl, must be out of her mind. What's happening here?
She is and she's not. You know, so the thing that you've heard from Elizabeth Warren is Medicare for all, and then you had the scolds out saying $53 trillion, right? By the way, whenever you hear those numbers in a federal budget context, it's over 10 years. Everybody goes over 10 years. So it's not $53 trillion in 1 year. It's $5.3 trillion in 1 year. Okay. Oh, but that's okay. But that's an implausibly large number. But then you've also heard her say it's 23, 24 trillion. So, you know, 2.3, 2.4 a year, right? Which is an implausibly small number. The real number is somewhere in the middle, and nobody knows exactly where. But the problem with this is, from both sides of the aisle, that are both attacking her and supporting her, is that the majority of that is not new spending. What the majority of that is shifting the private part to today, right now, we spend about $4 trillion, about 20%, 20 to 20, a little over 20% of GDP on healthcare. It's 500% overpriced due to monopolies and fraud. Okay, so we are spending five times as much as we should be in a market system because of the monopolies, the socialism, and the fraud. But that 20, that $4 trillion, one and a half is government, and the rest is private. It's your health insurance premiums that are paid for through your employer and whatever have you. What Medicare for All does is take that two and a half and put it all on the federal budget. Okay? So it takes the four and moves it all onto the federal side. Well, but the two and a half comes off the private side. Right? So the total amount spent probably doesn't change very much. But the price signal problem remains. So it still keeps going up at 8% a year, just like it does now in the federal side. Nothing that Warren is proposing addresses that, except for attempting to ration things, which is what's happening in Canada and in the National Health Service over in Great Britain. Because without price signals, the only thing the government can do is turn around and say, well, guess what? You happen to be of the wrong political persuasion, or you drink too much, so you don't get any health care. And that's the way they'll control the cost. They won't do anything about the actual cost. And here is the other nasty part of this, and this is why the Republicans and the people on the right don't want to take this on. Over the last 10 years, we have put approximately 400,000 people a year into the workforce that are not doctors and nurses, but they work in the medical industry. They're all paper pushers. These are all people between the insurance companies, the hospitals, the doctor's offices, and all they do is handle the billing and taking people's money and reorganizing that money to go out to different people, pharmaceutical firms or whatever have you. They never provide one second of care to a single individual during their entire career. If you get the price signal back into the market, in other words, you were to pass a law that says you must post a price for every medically related thing and everybody must pay the same price. You can charge whatever you want, but no matter what kind of insurance I have, no matter who I am, no matter if I get one IV of blah and your price says it's $400, it's $400, no matter who I am and no matter how I pay. All right. If you did that, then all of a sudden everyone would have a reason to shop, okay, and prices would fall like a stone. But what happens to these 4 million people who have been hired to push paper and can't be paid for anymore when the cost of care goes down by 80%. They all get fired. Now, there would be a very severe contraction in the economy, probably about 12 to 15% immediately. It wouldn't last very long because we would be the most competitive Western nation in the world to put a business, because the cost of running your business would go down by 15%, right? Because that would come out of your cost profile. But the dislocation and the short-term pain, what would happen to the stock market, what would happen to all the drug companies, Kaiser Permanente, you know, all the different hospital chains, everything. And by the way, the private equity guys have gotten into all of these practices, from doctor's offices to dental. Okay, you go into the dentist office now, and they'll say, well, you know, you could have, you know, this done or that done, and they'll hand you this treatment plan that's, you know, $25,000. Because, well, you know, this tooth is kind of unstable. You take this one out and give you an implant, and that's $3,000, and do this and that and everything. Long term, it does absolutely nothing. If your genetics are terrible, in 20 years, you're going to have dentures anyway. But they got $60,000 out of your pocket in the meantime. And the whole bottom line is these private equity guys come in, and they're revenue enhancing to the practice, all right, because they bought out the practice, and they want a return. But this is what happens when you have a socialist system and no price. There's no price mechanism. There's no feedback on this, on the system that says, no, I'm not going to pay that because the doctor down the street will see my sore throat and he wants $60. And then I'm going to go get a generic prescription for, you know, whatever it is that I'm told I should go buy at Walmart for $4. So instead, the insurance company gets billed $400. And guess what? That's why your premium is $800 a month.
I tell you what, everything has become such a monopoly, even healthcare.
Well, it's illegal. This is the real 900-pound gorilla in the room. Read 15 United States Code, Chapter 1. Just go ahead and Google it. Everyone that's listening to this should pull it up, Google it. Go on Google, 15 USC Chapter 1. Look at the Long Island, LII has all of the United States Code nicely indexed, really easy to read. You don't have to go look up the congressional record and all that nonsense. It's all right there, all the federal laws. Okay, every attempt to monopolize, restrain trade, or fix prices is declared a felony. It's not a civil offense, it's a criminal felony. Every person who attempts to do that is supposed to suffer 10 years in the slam slam and get fined $100 million for each occurrence if a corporation, or $1 million for each occurrence if a person. That law has been on the books for more than 100 years. It's the Sherman Act. It's shortly followed by the Clayton Act because the Sherman Act didn't criminalize conspiracies to do it. In other words, you actually had to do it and get away with it. So then a couple of years later, Congress realized that people were scamming and getting, they were conspiring to do it, but then they claimed, oh, no, we really didn't actually manage to get away with it. So they wrote the second section right after the first one that says just trying it is a felony. Okay. So you don't even have to succeed. And there is no exception for the medical industry. There are people who will probably come on this show after they see my appearance here, and they'll say, oh no, there's a law called McCarran-Ferguson that says that insurance companies are immune from this. No, it doesn't. There have been two cases, one in 1979, Royal Drug, and the other one, Maricopa County, a couple years later, that went all the way to the Supreme Court, where the insurance companies and drug firms tried to claim that insurance, because of McCarran-Ferguson's exemption, were exempt from antitrust when it came to medical care. They lost both times.
Wow.
I had my representative, Matt Gaetz, who likes to claim that he is a man of the people. I showed up at one of his town hall meetings with a bunch of senior citizens in it, and I nailed him with exactly this. And he ran that same line of crap on me, that McCarran-Ferguson said that this was not against the law.
Wow.
In front of a bunch of gray hairs, all of whom are getting screwed by this. He knows full well he's lying. He doesn't care.
Oh, that's shocking. Matt Gaetz?
Matt Gaetz. And I gave him my card at the end of that, with the exact cite to it, the two cases, and said, you're wrong. He says, oh, I'll get back to you. My phone never rang. This was over a year ago.
Do you think, number one, why isn't this being enforced? And number two, do you think it's just become such a gargantuan gorilla that to enforce it would rock our financial system so bad that they don't want to touch it?
Well, of course it would rock the financial system. You take 15% out of GDP and the stock market, the S&P would trade at 400. not for very long, but it would. The market would crash. We all know what would happen, right? I mean, how do you support asset prices when the theft and the fraud get ripped out from underneath them? You don't, right? But the fact is that everybody on both sides of the aisle knows this. Back about, it's probably around 2012 or thereabouts, I was invited to talk to a bunch of Senate staffers. And we were supposed to get about 10 minutes. I ended up getting about 20. And I put all these numbers in front of people. And I said, this is what's going to happen. What are you guys going to do about it? And the answer was nothing. And I said, well, why in the blankety blank not? And the answer was, we'll all lose our jobs. We'll have every pharmaceutical and medical representative out there saying we're going to throw Granny down the stairs. They'll be running ads with us pushing her in the wheelchair, and then down the stairs she goes, and we'll all get fired because of the corrupting influence of money in politics. which is very true. But the bottom line is none of these people are willing to stand up, go in front of the American people, and tell them the truth. Mm. And yet the data, and this is the most infuriating part of this. This is not a secret. The monthly Treasury statement comes out every single month. It's public information. How hard is this to figure out? It's right there. I've been tracing this stuff for the last 20 years. It's public.
I think the problem is, too, there's so much public information that people, it's just, you know, people would rather just sit down and watch, you know, American Idol. Because it's just, it becomes such a huge problem that your eyes almost glaze over when we talk about the data released on insurance companies, right, and medical fraud and all of, you know, impeachment and now the telephone call, and you got to read this and you got to research that. And then you're left to trust the media, because that's their job, is to go through this stuff, whittle it down, and bring the truth to the American people. What is the truth? It just depends on who's...
Oh, well, gee, the media. So, you know, I have the football game on last night. After I got done running, I'm having a beer and you know, the football game's on. What are basically every third ad is, you know, get your erectile dysfunction drug or your drug for this or your drug for, you know, is what is it, 50% medical ads now from the very industry that's robbing us all blind, and you expect this industry to come up and say, oh, by the way, you guys are all thieves and brigands and you all ought to be in prison? I don't think that's going to happen.
It's controlled so much. I mean, it's so transparently controlled by the advertisers, and people know this, because if they don't like something, if Laura Ingraham says something wrong, oh, there's a list of her advertisers out on Twitter to millions of people, because they know that it's the corporate advertisers that actually control what's allowed to be said.
That's sure. And yeah. But you know, this is when you get down to it, within the next few years, no matter who wins the next presidential election, no matter which way the House goes, And I mean, Trump, there's going to be a bill of impeachment that's going to come out of the House. I think that's a pretty much a foregone conclusion. There are enough Democrat votes to do that. And it's going to go absolutely nowhere in the Senate, just like it did with Bill Clinton. And the political blowback on that is hard to figure out, because you have a very different environment today. There is about a quarter of the people on the left side of the aisle that are just flat out crazy, that are the reason that we have this sort of screen fest going on right now, because they're demanding it. Okay. This is what they insist on. So it's, and Pelosi knows if she loses a quarter of her caucus, she loses her speaker's gavel. All right. And so, I mean, you know, she doesn't have that many extra votes to give up, and she knows this. So, you know, I mean, it's all through a political lens, but on the other side of it, you know, the Republicans also know that if they were to vote to remove the president, they would never win an election again. Not only will they lose in 2020, but they'll lose the Senate, and then the Democrats will turn around and pack the Supreme Court, and they'll never win anything. All right, so, I mean, there's, you know, this is a blood sport, okay, when you get down to it, and these people are fighting for their political lives, and everything else is, you know, is damned, because that's secondary to making sure that you don't lose your seat. The problem is that whether you like it or not, mathematics does not sleep, and mathematics are not political. You can't do anything about exponents. And I wrote an article a number of years ago that used the metaphor of a lily pad, and it points out the problem with an innumerate population that does not understand the basics of arithmetic, especially when it comes to the exponential functions. And the issue is that when you are one doubling period away from certain death, everything still looks fine. The sun's out. Everything's wonderful. You don't see any problems. You've gone through many of these periods. You're one away from having to do absolutely dramatic things, or you're going to die for sure. And yet, everything still looks beautiful. And that's just the way exponents are. And when it comes to budgets and financial calamities like this, what that means is that it'll look like you're okay with your budget. You can sell your debt. You can run your deficits. Everything looks fine. Everybody's still getting their Medicare. Everybody's still getting their Medicaid. Everyone's still got their private insurance. The hospital's still open. All of this is okay. And in the space of 3 or 6 months, it all goes to hell. And there's absolutely, at that point, there's nothing you can do about it, because how do you finance any further expansion of this? You go try to sell the debt, and people that are going to buy it say no. The Fed, if it tries to monetize this and drive rates negative, what people need to understand about negative interest rates is that they're deflationary, directly, mathematically deflationary. If I give you $10,000 on a negative 1% bond for 10 years, at the end of 10 years, you're going to give me back $9,000, right? Well, that's deflation. Okay. And so the idea that the Fed can create inflation by doing things that are mathematically deflationary is nonsense. The other problem you have is that all of the net present value pricing formulas in the bond market, if you try to do them with a negative rate, you essentially end up somewhere in that series of calculations you try to divide by zero, which means you can't, of course. So all those pricing models go away. There is no way to value a negative rate bond on a net present value basis. Bonds are supposed to have three purposes in the capital structure. They are a store of value against an allegedly safe thing. They are a source of coupon interest, in other words, interest payments. Okay, and they are a speculative instrument, because you can buy a bond when the rates are at 5%. You think they're going to go to 4. That will make the value of your bond that's at 5 go up, because if I want to buy one, I can only get 4 now. So the one that pays 5 is worth more money. All right, so I can sell it for a higher price. All right, as soon as you get rid of the positive interest rate environment and it's gone, those two values, I can't use it as a store value because I'm guaranteed to lose. I can't use it as coupon because I'm not getting one. Well, what's left? Speculation that the rates will go down even further, more negative, and therefore I can sell it to a bigger fool. But that's all that's left. So you've taken two of the three purposes of bonds in capitalism and destroyed them. And this is what we're talking about doing as a solution to the world's problems financially? Are you crazy?
That's just insane.
It's nuts.
So the only direction is down.
Well, someone in the political sphere needs to, and maybe the people in this country need to find their pitchforks and torches and essentially force the politicians to cut the crap. Okay? Because if not, yeah, we're going to continue to play this game, you know, make America great again, keep America great again. Wow, man, I passed these tax cuts. Well, you know what? Think about this. He did pass tax cuts, but one of the things we were promised was that they'd be paid for with reduced spending. How'd that work out? We just ran a $1 trillion deficit last fiscal year. By the way, that was $1.2 trillion, not 890-some billion. The Treasury always lies about that because they don't count the Medicare and Social Security deficits. They're off balance sheet.
Yeah, I want to turn to the topic of the president just briefly before we go.
Sure.
I know that you've talked about, you laid out your prediction for the result of the impeachment, that, you know, Democrats will stay Democrats, Republicans will stay Republicans, they're all covering themselves, therefore there won't be an impeachment ultimately because it has to go through the Senate.
Right.
But I want to approach this problem that the president is attempting to deal with. It's grown into such a gargantuan problem before he even hit the scene. But how much power does he have to fix this? Because, you know, whenever you're elected, say you were elected president, and mm-hmm. you go to Washington, your president, do you have a magic all-power wand to fix everything? Or what is he up against in that's blocking him? Because you just mentioned something. He talked about his plan, but he's been blocked almost every direction he moves. The only place he can really go is outside our country to renegotiate our trade deals, in which that he has much more power there. What is he actually able to do? I know that he's trying very hard. But
no, he's not.
What's your perspective? Okay, give us your perspective.
No, he's not. Article 2, which is the presidency, the executive, is charged with enforcement of the law. OK, Okay, that's the oath he takes when he comes in. So if you made me president, I would put my hand on the Bible and I swear to faithfully execute the Constitution and the laws of the United States. Okay. The antitrust laws have been on the books for over 100 years. He could tell his attorney general to enforce them now, to impanel grand juries and bring indictments. And if Bill Barr told him to pound sand, he could fire him and replace him with somebody else who will. And he could keep doing this until he got someone who would do it. He could call me, and I'd be more than happy to be his attorney general and start laying indictments on these guys. All right, I would take great pleasure in doing it. I might need, 16,000 bodyguards because they probably put a contract on my life. But I'd be more than happy to do that. So he has that power. The other thing that he has near plenary authority in a number of other areas. And one of the places that the president is ignoring the law is this area with injunctions that are coming out of specifically the Ninth Circuit on a national basis. Those are invalid. The circuit court system is set up by Congress. The only court system defined in the Constitution is the Supreme Court. All the rest of them are creations of Congress. Congress divided the jurisdictional boundaries of the United States into circuits and districts, and then they set rules for getting into federal court that say that you have to have a controversy that meets a certain amount of dollars, and there normally has to be a diversity of jurisdiction. So I'm in Florida, you're in Washington, okay? There has to be some diversity between there. Otherwise, you got to sue me in state court. You can't sue me in the federal system because, now, if there's enough money involved, you can. But the problem is this, those courts have jurisdictional boundaries. You do not want a judge in California telling you in Alabama that you can abort born children. You also don't want a judge in Alabama telling someone in California they can't have an abortion at all. All right? And the tension between those things is what ultimately leads cases to go to the Supreme Court, which is the one that is defined in the Constitution, and then they decide that controversy once there are conflicting decisions. What the Ninth Circuit has done is allowed people to form shop. Basically take jurors and say, okay, I'm going to find somebody who is in California that has a beef with policy X, and we're going to file here. But that would be okay if the ruling was limited to that district and that circuit. But it's not. These judges are issuing injunctions that have national effect. They're void beyond the Ninth Circuit. They have no force or effect whatsoever. And the president has every right to turn around and say, I'm not going to pay any attention to them beyond the boundaries of the Ninth Circuit. I'm going to ignore them as if they don't exist.
But Carl, let me ask you something. From the perspective of the media, which controls much of the perspective of the American people.
Well, they'd be all over them.
Yeah, and they're already all over him right now. It's almost like everything he does is painted as being some sort of impeachable offense, you know?
Right, so you know what? So go ahead and bring that through the judicial process. Where does it end up going? Ultimately, it goes to the Supreme Court.
Right. But then he ends up having 20 or 100 of these when everything he does, they talk about it's an impeachable offense, and so now he's in, problem after problem after, but sure. His presidency has been this way.
Well, but here's the other thing. Why doesn't he grow a pair and tell Nancy Pelosi, I'm not signing a budget. I'm not working with you. You can go bite me as long as you keep doing this. He has the power to do that. Now, they can say, well, that's an impeachable offense. Okay, if you can get the Senate, if you can get the Senate to agree with you, that's fine, but remember that when an impeachment goes to the Senate, the House has lost complete control over the process at that point. The Senate is entitled to make its own rules. When Clinton was impeached, the Republicans in the Senate tried to get Rehnquist, the Chief Justice is the presiding officer over the Senate during a presidential impeachment. They wanted him to issue what amounted to a jury charge to the senators that said you must consider all the evidence before you in a fair and impartial way, like you'd be if you were sitting on a jury in a courtroom. Rehnquist said, no, that's not what the Constitution requires. And so what he told the Senate is, you're free to decide this however you'd like. If you want to take this vote entirely on partisan grounds, if you don't even want to look at the evidence, you don't have to. There is no constitutional rule that says that you have to pay attention to anything that you don't want to. This is entirely up to you. This is a political process, not a judicial one. And that was the charge he gave to the Senate. That's the way it works. And it's the way it's supposed to work, because this impeachment is a political remedy. It's not a criminal remedy. It's not a civil remedy. It's a political remedy. So if the House thinks that they have articles, let them send them over. The Senate, you know, look, the Senate can turn around and say, both sides have equal right to call witnesses as they wish and issue all the subpoenas they want. Who's the first person I subpoena if I'm Donald Trump? Joe Biden. And then we'll subpoena Obama. And we're going to subpoena Hunter, his son, right? And then we're going to get the Burisma. We're going to get all the Burisma guys. Archer, this guy who was a pal of Hunter's that got convicted, and then the conviction was thrown out on a technicality. He was actually convicted as a felon in another fraud, and then that conviction was set aside. There was some irregularity within the process, and he got it overturned on appeal. So he's not a convicted felon under the law, because he was ultimately exonerated, but he did get busted. And so, you know, so I mean, you bring all these people in front of the court, so to speak, right? And do they really want to go there?
That could be a result of, let's say it goes through the House and they do what they do. You know, everybody's complaining about it. It's horrible. It's terrible. It's secret. It comes to the Senate. And the Senate says, okay, let's subpoena Biden and Hunter Biden and Obama. And they open up the whole floor into all these questions that have been going on for years and years. And we really look into it. That's an extraordinary perspective that I hadn't even thought of.
I don't think it goes that way, though. My guess is that one of two things happens. Either Pelosi realizes that if she actually allows us to get voted out into formal articles, that she's going to get hammered. And so she refuses to bring the bill on the floor, which she can do. As a speaker, she has absolute control over what goes on the floor. The only way to force something on the floor without her consent is what's called a discharge petition. And you need a supermajority of the House to do it. She won't get any Republicans going to vote for that. So, if she decides that, wait a minute, this was a really bad idea, then, you know, then it dies there. But the other thing that's rather likely is I could see McConnell kicking this into the Judiciary Committee, having it come back out on a no recommendation, okay, which is basically means the Judiciary Committee votes against it, and then he kills it on a procedural vote with 51 votes. And he's got 50 plus Pence, who's the tiebreaker. And, and that's given the couple that would peel off and would probably vote to continue the process. Because he's got a couple of Republicans that aren't really Republicans, you know, Collins and a couple of others. But he probably has 50 plus one to kill it without even having actual hearings, which the Senate has the right to do. The House has no control over the process once it leaves their hands.
Okay, so this could turn into something very interesting. Either we have the whole debacle coming to the Senate and they kill it, we're not even going to look at it, they've got that option. Or they say, okay, let's look at it, but let's look at everybody. Let's bring in Brennan, let's bring in Obama, let's bring in
absolutely. I think this is a disaster for the Democrats if it goes into the Senate, no matter how it happens, because the crazies on the left will go nuts if they don't get the bill. Okay, if it goes into the Senate and gets killed on party line, they're going to even be even more insane. And if it all comes out and the entire thing turns out to have been a scam from the start, okay, there really was corruption in Burisma. It's, you know, we actually get to the bottom of it. And incidentally, there's two pieces of information that have recently come out. And I suspected there was something behind this, which was why the Democrats were so weird about it. One of them is that a month before the election, there was a luncheon held in the White House. A guy managed to shake loose the information with an FOIA. And all of these so-called whistleblowers and their pals were with Biden, the Italian prime minister, for a state luncheon. Now, why is that important? Because Mifsud, who's the guy that started all of this with the dossier, Durham found him in Rome. What country is Rome in again?
Italy.
Uh-huh. So, gee, 1 month before the election, all these guys that are now doing this were in the White House at a state luncheon with the Italian prime. Gee, and oh, by the way, what were they doing there, and why were they specifically part of this? You know, there are no coincidences in politics, okay, especially not when there's like 10 people involved. There was something funny going on there. And then, you know, you got that, and then you got this thing with Biden. There's now...
Carl, nutshell that one more time for everybody, because I want everybody to really absorb what you said. 1 month before the election, we had the whistleblower. Go on.
Yeah, the alleged whistleblower. Remember, we don't officially know his name, right? The alleged whistleblower, one of the original operatives that produced the Steele dossier that was paid by the Democratic National Committee, and a handful of other people involved in its production, along with Joe Biden personally, at a state luncheon for the Italian Prime Minister in October of 2016, 1 month before the election. And this was during the time that Steele was pushing the dossier to get out into the public before the election because he wanted to discredit Donald Trump. And all the people that were involved in it were in this luncheon with the Italian Prime Minister, and Durham manages to find Mifsud in Rome.
And all of these people were with the alleged whistleblower that is doing all this right now.
Well, and he got, now the interesting thing is he got this DNC hack into the luncheon, and nobody seems to know how, because he wasn't that, he's a GS employee. He's not somebody that has a lot of diplomatic clout. So let's chase this one down and see where this goes.
Wow. So it all circles back to the same people just doing it.
It does. There's, and again, this is all smoke at this point. We haven't seen the flames yet, but there's an awful lot of smoke.
Now I stopped you. You were going into one more point. And I think,
there's another. So we have some other information that has recently come out about Vindman, who was apparently admonished by one of the people at his chain of command for slagging the United States when he was on post. And now all of a sudden he's screaming that Trump is this evil person because he's supporting the United States and he thinks Ukraine has problems. So, I mean, there's all these different people and there's all this data that's coming out. People have been filing FOIAs and lawsuits for years about a lot of this stuff. In many cases, some of the stuff's 2-3 years old. But we're finally getting to the point where courts are ruling and documents are being issued and, they're getting, it's like Judicial Watch. They go in and they file all this stuff and you don't hear anything for a year or two because it takes time to work through the process. But eventually all this stuff comes out and what we're seeing is more and more evidence that, there was some smoke there. I mean, exactly where it goes, well, until you get testimony, you're not going to know.
And testimony could very well be coming as a result of this impeachment.
If it goes into the Senate, it's very likely it will.
Carl, everyone, I guarantee you, all of our audience is like, what? Okay. This has been an amazing interview. Please tell everyone where they can go to follow your work.
Market-ticker.org. Something new every day.
Yes, indeed. Mr. Carl Deniger, one of our favorite guests and the host, of course, of Market Ticker Podcast at market-ticker.org. Thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thank you anytime.
It's been brilliant. For the Industry Experts Panel, I'm Michelle Holliday at PortfolioWealthGlobal.com.